So she brings a breadth of experience to talking about this participatory way. But yesterday, a lot of us talked about evaluating partnerships, so she can add to that, or however you want to ask her later. Tantau League is a, we just were trying to figure out when we first knew each other from the early 90s. Met at APHA in popular education workshop. She's a very popular educator par excellence, and does incredible participatory work, as does Charlotte, in trying to involve people within partnerships to be involved in a real action, interactive way on all of the research issues. Pam is the founder and now on the board of directors of the Chinese Progressive Association, one of the core partners to this partnership, and has been actually very active with many labor organizations and Unite here, local, and other labor organizations. Is also former chair of the Asia Pacific Environmental Network and on the academic staff of the School of Public Health, also program.
Now every day is Saturday.
I think these folks represent, embody a truly collaborative and loving partnership.
Our project in Chinatown with restaurant workers there as kind of a case example to kind of take you through what some of the things that we did to engage community partners in these stages as we were looking at working conditions and health and safety for restaurant workers in Chinatown here. But just before we get started, Pam and I are interested in who's in the room here, and so we just wanted to ask, for maybe a show of hands or shouting out, who in here would say that they come from the community side of things? They might be a community partner. Great, thank you. How about a university partner? Who might do that? Great, thank you, welcome. Students? All right. Thank you for coming. How about other partners? Health departments, other agencies, other stakeholders? Great, thank you. How many are local to the Bay Area? All right, we got a good contingent here. And how many are out of town? Very good, welcome to the area. And how many of you would say that have some CBPR experience? Great, a lot of you. And how many of you are sort of just getting started and learning? A lot of the same hands going up. Very good. Well, so glad. We're hoping to hear from you and your experiences and your questions. And no matter whether you have years of experience or whether you're coming in with new, fresh perspectives for us to really help to help us think better about this as well. So we know that CBPR involves all the partners in all stages of the research. But I do think that these stages of designing instruments, collecting data, and interpreting data data really do sort of bring out kind of the nitty gritty often of the research. It's, you do get kind of, there's a lot of planning, there's a lot of details involved in, you know, in thinking through these processes, and they can introduce new challenges to partnerships as they're evolving. You know, so as you're looking at research instruments, deciding which questions that you're going to include, what kind of response options they respondents should have, you know, how which ones are most important, how to prioritize them. Then thinking through the administration of the research, okay, how is that going to happen? Taking into account the sort of institutional review board requirements and amendments and things that have to go along with that. And then looking at the data, which often involves poring over numbers or text, and really trying to, you know, work pretty hard to think through, you know, what kind of patterns you're seeing and why are you seeing that and what that really means for the communities involved. And, you know, there's actually a good amount of, you know, let's be honest, tedium, right, involved in some of these things. And so I think they do really introduce some challenges to partnerships. And the gap between cultures, I think, also becomes highlighted here. And culture meaning not just ethnic culture and language, which certainly is one layer, but certainly the research culture, which advantages professional researchers, and sort of the culture of community members, their work cultures, their everyday lives, and how you have to kind of bridge any gaps that are occurring there. When you do, in fact, then add on layers of ethnic culture, language, and those complexities, those add an additional layer of preparation time and other dynamics that partners need to work through. But then, of course, they're not just cultural differences and gaps, but they're also advantages. They're one of the reasons why we really care, why we really want to engage in this process, because there's so much richness that comes out of bringing these diverse partners together, their diverse expertise, and grounding them, and grounding the entire research process and the action that follows in the context of the community, in the language and experiences that the community can relate to. So that was the situation we were in with the with our partnership, the San Francisco Chinatown Restaurant Worker Health and Safety Study. And so we're gonna start out with an overview of the research project and our approach that we took. We're gonna highlight along the way ways in which the community organizing goals of our community partner were involved. How popular education, which as Nina mentioned, Pam is one of the best in, and CBPR were all woven together to really build on the community capacity and really provide kind of a sustainable and momentum generating path forward. And so, I just wanted to add that along the way, you know, just like many other partnerships, going through the nitty gritty of these research stages really did end up strengthening our partnership and the relationships between the partners as we went along. So just a little bit about the community first. How many folks here have been to San Francisco's Chinatown? All right, a lot of folks. So you'll know that it's population dense. It's a mixed-use neighborhood. It's all located in about 6 blocks of San Francisco. And it's an important tourist destination, but it still also remains an important cultural hub for the Chinese immigrant community here in San Francisco. About 5,000 people live there. Most of them are immigrants. And then about anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000 restaurant workers we estimate live in Chinatown or work in Chinatown in the a little over 100 restaurants that are located there. And Chinatown restaurants are also important to the local community economy, especially as manufacturing has declined in San Francisco over the past few decades. Restaurant work and this kind of service work has really become very important, particularly for new immigrants coming over who are kind of facing immigration-related challenges, including language, culture, education not translating, and other issues related to, you know, the context of reception. So why are we looking at restaurants? Well, restaurants, again, are this important employer in Chinatown, but they also account for, nationwide, the largest number of reportable injuries and illnesses of any one industry in the United States. Yet not a lot of research has necessarily been done on this, on the populations and the health and safety issues that they face. And so this was an opportunity to look more closely at that. And when we talk about health and safety, we really defined health pretty broadly for this in our partnership. And so health and safety included some of the more traditional occupational health and safety concerns: cuts, burns, slips, trips, and falls, kind of the most common. Also, temperature, chemical, fire hazards, stress, pace, the fast pace of work, and the physical demand of the job. So those health and safety concerns. But then also the health concerns that are related to wage theft. And so, you know, some of the economic stresses and that face workers when wage theft occurs. So not being paid minimum wage, the legal minimum wage, not being paid overtime, having wages stolen, never paid out, that kind of thing. So our partnership was formed in 2007, and it came to a close in 2010, but partners have really continued to stay in contact and support each other in the work that has followed, a lot of it that has been related. And it involved community, university, and health department. And so the community, our community partners were at the Chinese Progressive Association, which is a grassroots organizing group in Chinatown, and the worker partners that they recruited and who are members of that organization. We had two university partners. One was UC Berkeley School of Public Health. Meredith Minkler, who's sitting in the audience, was our PI. And we also had an LOHP, the Labor Occupational Health Program, as part of the School of Public Health there. UC San Francisco's Occupational and Environmental Medicine Division, one of our researchers came from there. And then we had the San Francisco Department of Public Health also as one of the partners. And just a note about the Chinese Progressive Association. So they're wonderful. They've been around for 40 years organizing workers. Many of their campaigns around winning back wages that have been owed to workers, and they've really been at the forefront of building alliances across the city among low wage workers who are experiencing the same thing that we're seeing in Chinatown, only sort of on the city level at large. And they've been very involved in sort of organizing on a broader scale, uniting these different working communities, and they've won some really critical victories, which we'll be talking about a little bit later. So for our project aims, they really fell into sort of four main groups. One was to establish an effective CBPR partnership. So thinking about CBPR principles and the spirit of CBPR, how can we build a partnership that really reflects those? Then it was to conduct an ecologic study of working conditions and health. And we did two main things in our research. One was that we developed an observational checklist that could be used by the San Francisco Department of Public Health partners. They could go into restaurants and actually go through the checklist and look to see which hazards or which problem areas were present. And then the other part was a worker survey of over 400 workers on their own perceptions of health and safety, of their own health status and conditions and their working conditions. Then the third part of it was to disseminate the finding. After conducting the research, was to disseminate the findings and translate that research into action to lay the foundation for policy change and to do the necessary community outreach and education as well. And then finally, it was to evaluate the partnership according, again, to the CBPR principles, to the common CBPR principles, and also for the goals that they laid out that we've laid out for ourselves. And throughout this entire, throughout the entire project, worker leadership development and community organizing goals that had already been for a long time a part of the strategy of CPA and the community were kind of infused and integrated and interwoven into each one of these pieces. I guess I'm on a timer. So one of the things things that was really critical was that we established participatory structures, including things like having a project steering committee and having subcommittees, and in a moment I'll be talking about the worker leadership committee. But these were, there a lot of time went into thinking about what would be the best way of ensuring that people were able to participate in the as well as they possibly could. And so a lot of time was spent on relationship and trust building, setting up these procedures and structures, and in particular the, you know, our what we wanted to ensure that workers who were not speaking, not generally not English speaking, and were coming from, you know, kind of a not the research world, and coming from an immigrant worker community, would have, would feel comfortable and very ready to participate. And the evaluation, which I was a part of, was intended to sort of track this and to make and to try and see how well or how where we needed to improve in terms of everybody's participation. So a critical component of the structures was in fact the worker leadership group, and this involved throughout the course of the project about 9 workers who were really the core partners representing the community on the project. And they shared insider knowledge, they, you know, they participated and co-developed, you know, the various instruments and pieces of the research, including the survey in particular and the checklist. They interpreted findings, and then they were integrally involved in the education dissemination and the dissemination of findings and the planning for action and for policy change. And so our research activities kind of looked like this. So on the worker end, worker survey end of things, which is really where the greatest amount of focus for the worker leadership group was focused. For that, the partners co-developed a standardized survey instrument, which focused on working conditions, on health status, on access to services, on civic participation, as well as other conditions that affect workers and community members. And they were done by community members, by workers, in through interviews in Cantonese, Mandarin, and Toisanese, by a group of 17 folks, which I'll talk about more. And then all in all, 433 workers completed the survey. On the restaurant observation end, again, partners co-developed this 13-item checklist. The Department of Public Health was responsible for collecting the data, and that was completed in 106 of the 108 restaurants that were in Chinatown at the time. So before anything else could really happen, before we could really sort of jump into the research process, we had to make the case for why the community should be investing their limited time and resources in doing research as opposed to engaging in other community organizing activities and alternatives. And so we had to make the case for why it would be useful and relevant. And here, I think, is where bridging roles really made a really critical difference. And PAM was a huge part of this. Our partners at CPA were a huge part of this. Our worker partners were a huge part of this. So PAM, who brought with her a whole background of facilitating participatory research with workers in the past, approached CPA, did a lot of the bridging to make the case to CPA for why research could really help, you know, provide an evidence, sort of a source of evidence for documenting problems. And then in turn, CPA organizers and staff made the case to our worker partners. And then the worker partners in turn then made the case to additional surveyors that they hired, as well as community members that they were inviting to participate in the survey. And so here you can see some goals that the CPA and the worker partners put together on when they were thinking about why they were engaging this, what they were hoping to get out of it. And so it includes connecting to other restaurant workers and understanding the reality of workers' conditions, documenting and publicizing these conditions to key policymakers, media, and the public, to educate and mobilize workers to improve conditions, and to conduct a study that is led by workers and helps workers. And so Pam will be talking a little bit more about this in her part, but throughout the various sessions of that that Pam and CPA led with the worker partners to do some training and research, a popular education approach was used. And in particular, you know, sort of that interactive, learner-centered, and participatory approach was kind of infused throughout. And then also that kind of cycle of reflection and action that Nina was talking about earlier. So this is just an example of an agenda that was used in one of the worker sessions, and you know, they were translated into Chinese. The organizers, including Pam and folks at CPA, often had an English language one that we were working off of. But in general, Pam, before the sessions, Pam would work with CPA staff to develop an outline of what would happen during the day, what some of the goals and objectives would be, and CPA staff and organizers would then take that and develop out their own curriculum and their own trainings. And so there was kind of this, again, kind of stepwise process. But the idea was really to let the community-based organization take the lead on this in this step. And a lot, one of the advantages was that CPA folks and organizers could develop the relationships that are so critical with the worker partners. And then also CPA has the expertise, the language, the kind of the cultural understanding and the ability to really integrate that fully into their organizational goals. When Mary and I and others on our partnership attended some of the worker leadership meetings, we would wear headsets where we would have simultaneous interpretation of into English of what was happening. There were a lot of languages going kind of flying around, but the focus was really on ensuring that that the meetings and the sessions were happening in the language in a language that the workers were, you know, the workers were speaking. So we developed a lot of materials. And when I say we, I should really say Pam and CPA, and you know, with the assistance of a lot of our other partners. But we developed a lot of materials, including things like a flowchart, which they would periodically, this was translated in Chinese, as pretty much most things were. And periodically they would take this out on a big sort of flip chart paper and track and check off, you know, which step by step, stage by stage, where are we now, and we could actually see where we were going. And that I think was really helpful in sort of keeping the big picture in mind. These are some pictures of the initial trainings. This is Fei Chen, who was an organizer at CPA during one of the first sessions. This is another picture from one of the first sessions of the workers engaging in the trainings. So then, you know, having sort of given the overview, making the case for the research, then it was possible to really start delving into, you know, sort of the nitty-gritty, like designing the study instruments. And so one way that, one example where of how worker input was brought out was through the activity of risk mapping, which many of you may be familiar with. And in this case, what the group started off by brainstorming, our core worker partner started off by brainstorming, what are all the different areas of a typical Chinatown restaurant or a range of Chinatown restaurants? So we talked about the kitchen, the dining room, tea stations, dim sum carts, all these kinds of things. And then they split out into small groups. And they drew maps on big flip chart paper of, you know, kind of simple maps of what those areas of the restaurant looked like. And then they marked out all and listed out and put on the maps all the different kinds of hazards that they could imagine that workers in that section of the restaurant might encounter. And this generated a lot of, really great material for our research instruments. And you know, we know that CBPR can help improve the validity of instruments and improve the relevance. And this was certainly a case for our partnership for the checklist. The coming out of these activities was this idea of, okay, well, we had brainstormed, okay, is there a first aid kit available in the event that something should happen to a worker And the workers, as they were going through these activities, were saying, well, somebody should look actually inside the first aid kit, because oftentimes the box is there, but it might be empty, or there might just be a Band-Aid or two. And so that was added to the checklist. And then we were very interested in understanding how various problems, health issues broke down by job categories in the restaurants. And we had missed an entire one in the initial draft of the survey, which included the leafleters. And so if you have been to Chinatown, there are a lot of people handing out flyers inviting you to come to their restaurants to eat. And those people are working out oftentimes in the cold. They're running into traffic. They're getting yelled at by people in the street, by the store owners where they're that they're in front of, where they're passing out flyers. And so this they pointed out that this was a very sort of important and potentially very vulnerable group of workers to make sure that we capture. So then data collection was another stage. And during our data collection stage was where we ran into a lot of back and forth with the IRB, which involved a lot of, it involved a lot. I'll just leave it at that. But, not the least of which is really doing some of the training on for the community participants on, the protection of research participants, which is really critically important, particularly as we were asking people about working conditions negative working conditions that that could potentially get out and impact their jobs. And so Pam drew up a little worksheet to pass around at one of the trainings. And this is just an example of how she broke it down and how she kind of translated a little bit of the language. This again was translated eventually into Chinese. But it was called University and Government Rules for Conducting the Survey Project. Starts off with why are rules necessary. We're responsible for conducting the survey project so that nobody gets harmed during the project. No mistakes happen. And what's an example of a mistake? It's if a survey gets lost and names get out and people find out who took the survey. It's important that questions are written so that workers aren't influenced, and then there's examples of those. And then at the bottom, sort of more explanation of the IRB protocol and why it's important that we have to wait for approval in order for that to happen. You can just kind of see how some of the translation is happening. So there were also a number of other materials to be developed for the workers as they were carrying out the research. They were doing the recruitment, they were doing the collection of the data. And so there were a ton of forms that we developed in order to help the workers organize things, in order to help us track and make sure that we were tracking everything we need to. So they included a recruitment schedule, a recruitment form, a survey identification card, a scheduling card, a consent form, and so on. And all of these sheets were color-coded. There were folders that we gave the workers. There was a big, giant, sticky, the sort of mystery sticky cloth that LOHP uses, where you can post up the different worksheets that people are using. And workers got thorough training over, a few different times, walking through, okay, step one, this is what you do. Step two, this is what you do. How do we make sure that that people's confidentiality is protected? How do we keep track of the incentives that we are giving them? I think everybody got $20-$25 gift cards for participation. How do we make sure that names are separated from surveys and that sort of thing? So there was a lot of paperwork. And then finally, in the data collection part, the workers had decided that they wanted to hire, so we were going to need to be interviewing 400 people at least with a 103 item survey. And there were, at that time, about six of them, and they thought we probably could use some more help, and so they decided they wanted to hire additional surveyors from the community, workers and community members, to do it. And so so then they became the trainers, and they conducted participatory training for the new surveyors on the research, doing pretty much exactly what Pam and the folks at CPA had been doing with them. And so again, this was a part of the leadership training element that was infused into the process. Now, we did just want to mention that this celebrating the sort of success that happened after the workers had exceeded everybody's expectations, and particularly their own, in that they collected more than 400 surveys in the span of a little less than a month. And it was something that they had felt really daunted by, but then they saw that, you know, that they had really done it in sort of record time. And so as a way of celebrating, we took a field trip to Muir Woods and the beach, which is just northwest of here. And it was a beautiful day, and it really helped to sort of congratulate and help people feel really good about the amazing job that they've done, and really invigorate them for the next steps to come, thinking about when the findings come back and how are we going to use the findings to really improve conditions in Chinatown and in the city for workers. And one thing, you know, that really sticks, I think, with us is one woman, one of the surveyors who came on the trip and who had done a lot of the surveys, told us that this was the first time since she had come to the United States into San Francisco in over 10 years that she had left San Francisco. And so it was just this beautiful experience. You know, people were playing in the water. There's a three-legged race that you see going on here. So that was ended up being a very important part of things, too. So interpreting findings. This was the general process that we used. We, you know, things kind of started off when we actually got the data entered and cleaned. That was the job of the academic partners. They did a lot of sort of just descriptive analyses on their own, but then also took requests for analyses from the community from other partners. They prepared reports, and then they've been leading the academic publications. With the community partner, by which we mean CPA, they tended to, in this process, identify priority topics that they were thinking would be really probably pretty useful in sort of laying the foundation again for policy change, and they would request analyses from academic partners. They facilitated the interpretation sessions with worker partners, and then they prepared their own comprehensive report on the research and the context and recommendations, which we'll be talking about in just a moment. And they led the dissemination effort to the community and to policy action. And then for the worker partners, their job was to interpret the data, to take homework home to the community, so to kind of ground truth and check in with other members of the community. Does this actually sound right to you? This is what I think it means, but tell me what you think. They were collecting qualitative data along the way with this. They participated in making recommendations for change as a result of what they were finding in the research in the data, and then participating also in and leading the dissemination and action pieces. So kind of typically what this looked like, or an example of what this looked like for the data analysis, was that workers were paired up or put into small groups and assigned one or two survey questions. And so the findings had already come back, but they were told to, they weren't shown the findings at first. It was kind of, they were just given this, the questions. And then they were told to think how someone you know who works in a Chinatown restaurant might answer the question you've been assigned, and then be prepared to share this. And so thinking about, okay, what do we think the findings are actually going to show? What is the typical worker going to say about this? And so they would write this down, and then the question, then they would compare their what they thought they would see to the actual data findings. And then they would talk about whether there were any surprises or differences between what you thought you would see versus the actual findings. Do you think the finding actually reflects the reality out there? What else do you want to learn about this question? And what can we do with this question? Really, again, thinking, grounding things in the action component. And so generating these questions, you know, sometimes there might be questions for our academic partners, our university partners. Is there additional analysis that we want to see? Do we want to see it broken down by sex or by age or by, you know, the type of job that somebody does? Maybe that's sort of what's explaining some of the differences. And then there's other questions that we would like to ask the community. So what really went on here? This kind of surprised us. What do you, you know, what can you tell us that will help us explain that? And so this is just kind of an example of something they would get. It would be in Chinese. But this is one of the questions that and so workers got this, and in their groups, they thought that in general, answers would be clustered around good or fair. But here's what people really said. You know, they tended to be clustered a little bit more positive around very good or good. And in particular, you know, there were a good chunk of people, almost a quarter of people said that their health was excellent, and this actually puzzled the workers, you know, quite a bit. And so then, you know, again, that would prompt these questions of, okay, do we want to send questions back to our university partners for more analysis? Do we want to ask other community members about this? And so I just want to, I'm hoping this will work. I just want to play a little segment of from a day. I used to record these sessions to help me take notes for the evaluation. And this is a day from when they were examining data. And it starts with Pam explaining the activity, one of the CPA organizers interpreting for her. Then Pam asks Shasan, who's the lead organizer and who's doing the training also, to kind of model, you know, how she would do the activity. And then there's a little bit of a clarification of the question, and then things really start to get animated.
And like the last time, you're going to try to guess what you think that answer is to the particular question. So Shasan, can you read one of these and then just kind of give an example and then have people like guess what they think the answer is? That? Just pick one. So pick one.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Pick one. Backwards. 被欠薪。
Okay.
那就是在实际上所有保护的强迫人下场。曾经。曾经。被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经被欺负。曾经
he said, mom must get this like 90%.
他们就那天说，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个公司，那个 So, you know, you might have heard that, you know, they were arguing about the percent of people that they thought would actually report that they had been owed back wages. And there's one of the workers who said, oh, I think it's going to be around 90%. And then you hear the other workers going, no. Right? It's going to be something more like 40%. And they were kind of going back and forth. And you hear the, again, that mishmash of languages, English, Mandarin, Cantonese. And that's kind of how we operated, was everybody spoke, you know, whatever language that they could with whoever they could. And everybody did a little bit of interpretation for everybody else. And ultimately, you know, what we found was that, I should just say that we do have a lot of several CPA partners who speak all three, and so who would, you know, do a lot of the interpretation informally for us, and then we also had, you know, our professional interpreter there much of the time too. But just as a note, you know, they're talking about 90%, 40% being owed back wages. In fact, it ended up being 8% of workers from the survey who reported being owed back wages. There were many other instances of being reported of wage theft, but back wages specifically was quite a bit lower than they had anticipated. So this is just another picture of them doing the activities. And this is just kind of to show you what it looked like. And so there were, you know, big butcher paper questions up there. They were given those questions to think about. They wrote their guesses on sticky notes, and then the answers, the actual findings were uncovered, and that's how they kind of prepared or compared things. This question was work-related hazards in restaurants. This one was on workers' wages and health and the effect on housing situations. This one was on dignity and respect in the job. So that's just kind of a picture of what it looked like. And then, you know, one thing that I thought was really really exciting about the way the process unfolded was that, you know, especially when we did encounter these questions where workers anticipated things to look a lot worse than they did on the survey. Pam and our CPA organizers took the opportunity to sort of engage people in conversations about research and bias and what do you think is going on. So do you think it's that, so you were the ones Mary remembered this conversation, they were like, okay, so, you know, you were out there, we all together designed this instrument, then you guys went out and you were doing the interviews with people and collecting the data, and it looks like this. So do you think that, so let's think about whether it's an issue with something that happened in the process, something with our instrument, is there something that we could have done better that we didn't account for, or is it simply that reality is actually different from what we think it is? And so really sort of getting into some of these issues that I think all of everybody who, you know, that has training and research, who has training and research does to be critical about their own process. And so I thought that was a really great example. And there were times when they said, no, you know, I remember people seemed kind of scared to say anything bad about their bosses. And so there was something, you know, related to the process and, you know, some bias in reporting. And then other times it was, no, this was a good question. I think this is probably what's really going on, but we'll go back and we'll ask other people about it as well in the community. So just some more pictures, you know, with the flip chart paper at CPA offices. So just a lot of big butcher sheets up there on the walls. So here are just some selected findings from the survey. So we did find that 50% of people responding to the survey were not making the legal minimum wage, which was just such an astounding and huge finding and ended up being very compelling and important in the action to follow. Found that injuries on the job was common, including those burns, cuts, and strains. We found that workplace hazards were common. This was with the checklist, the observational checklist that the Department of Public Health found. People reported high levels of stress. A higher percentage of people reported fair or poor health than you would expect in the general population, the age-adjusted general population. A third of respondents described their health as getting worse from the previous year. And we also saw that people reported low levels of education and English language skills. So some of the challenges that arose in this whole process related to time and resources. I haven't talked that much about it, but the language component, the different languages that we were using added, you know, a whole extra layer of preparation and timing, you know, that you had to kind of factor into in order to get everything done ahead of time, to get it translated and then into the hands of all the partners. So time and resources. University requirements, especially, you know, the institutional review boards, as well as research rigor. So the use of validated scales, they can be very lengthy. There was a lot of discussion around that. Again, making the case between the research and what ultimately will benefit the community. And then this theme of my head hurts. It was a very common comment that the workers would say after a session of either designing the instrument or interpreting data analysis. We'd say, thank you, that was so great. And they said, but my head hurts now because they've just been poring over the numbers and they said that they needed some aspirin. So benefits of the research include that the community did in fact create their own report, which is called Check Please. It was translated into Chinese and Spanish. And it really sort of situated our research in the broader context of the community and some of the issues that the community was facing. And they launched it at a press conference where workers really did a lot of the facilitating and speaking. And it was in the presence of four supervisors from the San Francisco Board of Supervisors, mainstream and ethnic media. It's a little hard to see, but in the bottom right-hand picture, there's TV cameras everywhere. Workers were giving interviews. And it was attended by, you know, over 100 people, maybe 100, almost 200 people in the community. And around the same time, CPA was involved in forming an alliance called the Progressive Workers Alliance of other working people across the city who were finding the same conditions and the same challenges in their workplaces as we were finding in Chinatown, and really, you know, banding together to push for changes in policy to improve those conditions, particularly around the issue of wage theft. And so one of the huge policy outcomes from this project was that that an ordinance, a city ordinance, was passed to crack down on wage theft, to step up enforcement, to streamline it, and to also improve outreach to workers. And this was followed by, so it wasn't just an ordinance that was passed, but what followed was the creation of a wage theft task force to coordinate activities among agencies within the city in order to do a better job of enforcing against wage theft. And then a major win just earlier this year was with a pastry shop in Chinatown, where the Office of Labor Standards and Enforcement collected over $500,000 in back wages that were owed to workers. And much of that was attributed to the movement that this research project very much contributed to. And so here are a couple of pictures. The first, the one on the top left, is at the signing ceremony of the ordinance, which was in 2011 in September. And that's one of our worker leaders, and Alan and Shausan from CPA, speaking in front of the mayor at the signing ceremony. And then the other one is another worker partner, Asun, just in February of this year, speaking at the media event to celebrate the claim, the $500,000 claim against the pastry shop. So for me, this has been such an honor to be a part of this project. It's been such an inspirational story to be able to follow the story as it continues to evolve. It feels like every several months, there's some good news that means improved conditions for workers across the city. And so I thank you for giving me the opportunity to share some of our experiences with you. I'm gonna now turn the microphone over to Pam, who's gonna talk about leadership development and popular education some more, and some of the other ways in which culture played into this project.
Thank you, Pam. Well, I'm going to really ask you to help me with this part of the presentation, okay? Because I didn't get much sleep last night because I was thinking about Texas, and I was thinking about what's going to happen at 8 o'clock this morning, and so I'm really sleep deprived. So I'm going to need your help. So if you don't mind, if you can do that, and we're going to talk about what is my passion around working on this particular project. And I know that the discussion is around collect data collection and interpretation, but I just kind of want to step back. For me, is my passion in discussing the whole thing on popular education. And I want to be able to put all of this that was discussed by Charlotte and described in the context of a popular education approach to this work and the research, and how rich and deep that is, and what that richness looks like today. This is a project that started in 2007, and it's the implications and the benefits of this project is still reflective today, and I'll describe that in a moment. But you're going to kind of see me now talk about my passion, which is popular education approach to the research. And if somebody from the audience, and mainly from Marty's class, could read to us one of the aims in terms of popular education. If you could do that for me, please.
Aim to empower people with marginalized socially and politically to take control of their own learning and to effect social change.
So for me, this is the heart of the work in terms of how we approached what was to be done in San Francisco Chinatown. People who have been to San Francisco Chinatown or saw some of the pictures of the conditions of the restaurant workers and the faces and the people involved in this. For me, this is my compass. And having this in terms of at the forefront, when you do your research and involve the community, what is the actual goal? Well, I feel that this is, for me, how I approach the work, the agenda for that day, the activities that people are going to participate in, the discussions, the actions that people are going to be engaged in that correspond with the research. This is, to me, the heart and soul of why we do this. And it's basically to give voice and to be able to give power. And that power and the voice to be able to create change. And that change, for me, and looking at the kinds of ways in developing the agendas, developing the activities, posing the questions, crafting what kinds of discussions people are going to get into, it's a moment of transformation. It's you facilitating people to be able to find their voice and to be a part of the change that they need and they want. And so part of this piece that I want to talk about is to go back to this slide that was shown to you earlier with the leadership development and capacity building. And in looking at this, part of the strategy in terms of partnerships and within the partnerships, looking at the capacity, I feel it's really important. I want to share the strategy with you in terms of identifying who would be participating as the coordinators or the workers in this project. So you can see the slide. Charlotte showed that in the beginning of the project, people were shying away from calling themselves leaders. And where they were when you'd ask, well, why do you participate in this project? Why do you want to participate in this project? Why do you participate with the organization, Chinese Progressive Association Chinatown? And people would say, oh, because I care about people. I really like people. Well, that's good. That's good. You want people like that. Perfect. Great. But for this project, you have to be able to look beyond that and see this person, all of you care, right? Most of you are here because you care. But there are also in the communities that people will care. But we need participants who not only care, but have the potential and the desire to transform themselves to become leaders. Because you're doing this research, you're providing the data to the community, and the data needs to be used to make change. And you need people to be the change makers. And these are the people who will be the change makers. And they have to be able to be engaged in a process that enables them to transform, to find their humanity, to find their voice, to understand power, develop their skills, and to develop their courage to go beyond fear. And so the process, when you're thinking about these things, has to engage in with these goals in mind. And I'm so happy to be able to say that they were able to move from the beginning where they said, well, they were comfortable to call themselves coordinators, and they were comfortable to invite their co-workers and friends to seminars. And in that transformation then, now today, they stepped midway, it was like, okay, we are part of the analysis of the data and the next stage in terms of policy. We're no longer coordinators, we are now worker leaders. That transformation. Today, if you talk to the participants, they will say, I'm a leader in the Chinese Progressive Association. I'm a leader from Chinatown. That's where you want people to be. That's empowerment. And the leadership was able to, through some of these activities, in doing outreach, making presentations. During the course of this 2 years project, workers came to them with wage complaints of wage theft in the community. And one of them was at a poultry shop in Chinatown on Stockton. Well, first they were on Grant Avenue, and then they declared bankruptcy. And then they opened another shop up the street, one block, and under another name, but same owner, and committed wage theft again. And these kinds of things were happening in the community, and so it was getting people to go and pick it outside those poultry shops and not hide their face behind the billboard, but to be able to then, from hiding their face to putting the billboard down, to being on TV, to going inside and asking to talk to the owners. So these are the different kinds of things that needs to go along, that you shouldn't shy away for these kinds of activities to happen during the course of your research. People need to be engaged in the change that they want and need. So what I wanted to explain in terms of the strategy that we worked with the community group, is that they understood that if change was going to happen, if the issue of wage theft, which the workers in that community group identified as a problem, then we needed to be able to develop leaders. So there was a seminar that was conducted, and people were invited to come to learn about the work of the organization, to learn about, to discuss the issues that were facing Chinese workers in the community, working in the restaurants predominantly. And there was, I guess that about 50 workers came and participated in these seminars. And through those seminars, they learned about the work and to understand the difference in the kind of organization that this was, the difference between a service organization, a service providing organization, an advocacy organization, and an organizing organization. And to the importance of understanding the three different approaches to community work and the kinds of organizations that exist in Chinatown and other places. And to discuss this and to see the differences and how their organization that they were in right now did all three. They provide services, they would advocate, but what made them distinct from other groups is that they were organizing, meaning you mobilize people in the community, you educate them, and you get them to make change, and you become leaders, and you work for power and representation. So through these discussions, staff, people like myself, could identify those people who were like, yeah, I've been to that. They didn't say it that way. but I like that. I think that's right. And we did it through role plays and skits and things, you know, in terms of the difference between advocacy, and people would be giving speeches, and organizing, and you know, collective, you know, people, how they group and had meetings, and they go out and they make protest signs. So they understood. And through those kinds of things, you surface folks then, who you want to be able to get involved in this project. The second part of the strategy was then to talk about the restaurant potential for a research project that was going to happen, and what we would be wanting to do. And then some of the issues, their knowledge of the restaurant industry, their ability to really talk and work as teams with each other and communicate and problem solve, And so these kinds of seminars can happen, and then you could surface and see more about what people's skills were and commitment and views. And then introduction of the restaurant program and asking people, telling people that would be recruiting for this program, okay? And who was interested. So then people would say, oh, I'm interested in participating in this program. So then there was another group of meetings to discuss the details and the nitty-gritty about the program and what it would take. And then in most instances, an organization would say, okay, so all of you here, the 25 people in this room, you're all interested in this, let's sign you up and you're gonna be participants. And this is like, no. And I go, well, what's gonna happen? And well, they're gonna have to apply to be a participant. They're gonna have to be interviewed. They're gonna have to sign an agreement in terms of understanding their roles and responsibilities. So they're gonna have to come to another series of sessions to understand what participating in this program is going to be. And I remember talking to Mary about this, Mary Minkler, and Mary goes, oh my God, that's a lot. Are you sure? Do they have to do it that way? Are you sure? We're gonna change people away. People aren't gonna wanna participate. Well, lo and behold, out of the 25, 17 said, I commit to do this. I commit to be there every 2 weeks, and I commit to accountability in terms of you holding me responsible, and I commit to participating in other activities that will support my skill building to all of this. And this is a strategy that I want people to understand in terms of the end goal is you want to be able to identify participants, just like in terms of community participants, the folks within there that you're gonna involve in this project, that there be a commitment there and an understanding. Does that make sense? Any questions so far about that? So, and I wanted to go back to, you remember that there was a field trip that we took to Muir Beach, okay? So part of this leadership and transformation, when we wrote the grant, that workers who were engaged in survey collection, they would get a stipend, right? And we wrote the grant and people would get individual stipends. So in the meetings, then, okay, it was time for people to get their checks and their stipends, and you know, people recorded how many hours and all of that. And then in that discussion, people said, you know, we should think about how we use this money. Do we use it as individuals by ourselves? Because, goodness, people need the money, okay? Or should we pool the money? Well, let's pool the money, we'll pool the money. Let's pool the money and have a party. Okay, all right, we'll pool the money and we'll do something for the group of us. And I thought that that was just a wonderful moment in which, for us as grant writers, we would probably say, you know, stipends, individual, but this whole process, people started to understand and look out for each other. They developed community. This is the other piece that needs to happen, is the transformation, but the development of community and care for each other. And so this whole thing of, we'll pool our money and we'll have a party. And somebody goes, yeah, that's a good idea. And another person said, well, maybe we have enough. Do we have enough money to go on a field trip? And you go, wow, a field trip. And that's where the Muir Beach field trip came. Where have we never been? And people said, I've never been to the beach. And that's where we ended up at Muir Woods. I'm just gonna tell you stories, I'm sorry. The other thing that I wanted to explain in terms of the leadership is where we're at now. And they were in, through this process, there was a campaign to win a wage theft ordinance. Now that means San Francisco, they won already one of the highest minimum wages in the country for San Francisco. It's $10.55 an hour. And if everybody knows, the state is like $8 or something like that. Federal is what, $6? But what it needs is enforcement. So you can have this, but it's not enforced. So what the group engaged in was then the winning of a wage theft ordinance to enforce the minimum wage. And they won that. Well, within 6 months, before the wage theft ordinance, it would take about a year to win $750,000. 6 months after the wage theft, no, 4 months after the wage theft ordinance, it was citywide almost $1 million already. Okay? And this ordinance with that victory has benefited all low wage workers. So what I wanted to communicate is that this little study came out of San Francisco Chinatown, but the impact that it had citywide for everybody was huge. Right. Today, this is after the wage theft, I want to communicate that these worker leaders are still out there enforcing the minimum wage. They sit on the advisory board to enforce the ordinance. But also, this has taken another step in which workers inside these restaurants, because of through the work of these leaders now, are able to find their own voice inside the workplace. So recently, at a couple of the restaurants that filed, workers stepped forward to file a claim that these workers met with them, talked about what was going on, and mainly they were filing a claim for people who had already been fired. Okay. But in the discussion, it was, well, these things are happening to the people still working right now. Not paying $1,200 a month. Now, does that mean minimum wage?
No.
Okay. And getting what they call slop for food, being yelled at and hit in the kitchen by the supervisors, and other kinds of just horrible, terrible conditions. So these worker leaders talked to the few workers that came out, and within the course of 3 weeks of talking to them and then going and visiting other workers, within 3 weeks, these worker leaders have gotten the names and the addresses and phone numbers of all the workers in both restaurants. That's over 80 people in 3 weeks. And have gone out to visit them, to talk to them. And last week, there was a delegation where 60% of the workers signed a letter, a demand letter to the bosses, made a delegation to the boss, and workers left their shift at the other restaurant and in full uniform marched the 4 blocks to this restaurant and stood there in front of the boss and found their own voice to say, we need you to make change in this restaurant. Tomorrow he's supposed to answer, right? But this is the implication of things like this when it is done in a popular education way, in which you are really focused in on empowerment. Right. And here, I was a union organizer for 10 years. I mean, there was no way we were able to get 100% names and addresses of people working in the hotels that I service. in 3 weeks. This is how dramatic something like this can be. Okay. It's almost time. So the other aspects of popular education. Somebody read these other elements. There's just pages and pages of what popular is, but I just took a few of my favorites. So somebody read these.
Teacher and students learn together, recognizing, honoring, and incorporating cultural differences. It is based on the lived experience of those participating in the learning, creates context for participants, and discover their humanness.
So one of the things that taking a popular education approach to the work and the activities is we were looking at the issues of health and safety of the restaurant workers. And traditionally, when you think of health and safety and of restaurant workers, what are some examples of issues that might be raised? Shout out to me, just shout out. You've been in fast food restaurants, or you might have worked in restaurants. Some of the issues, what would you think?
Not enough training,
good.
Not getting breaks,
excellent.
Not being paid overtime.
Overtime, very good. Other issues? And health and safety wise, because Charlotte and I come out of health and safety in the workplace, right?
Injuries,
great. That's right, injuries from how?
Burns.
So those are some of the traditional things, right, around health and safety in the workplace and conditions. And so taking from a popular education approach, if you were a traditionalist and you wanted to engage the members, the workers, on understanding rights in the workplace or risks in the workplace, you would probably start talking right away about, so how many of you have gotten burns in the workplace, right? How many of you tripped and fallen in the workplace? Lifting hazards, these kinds of things. People would probably, we'd just go right into it. But we didn't. One of the things that what we wanted to do was to understand how folks saw the issue of health and safety in the workplace. And so what I want to share with you is we asked workers in terms of what they saw as the health and safety issues in the workplace. This is in Chinese, but the next slide should be in English.
Yeah,
okay. So when I asked the workers, and taking from where people start, right, and how they see the issues, these were some of the key things that people really identified as their issues in the workplace. Somebody read them, because I'm losing my voice.
Should I be providing my own gloves for dishwashing? If there is an emergency or a worker gets hurt, should we call 911? What should we do if a coworker gets hurt? Should I be paid wages during the period when I am first starting my job? Can the boss deduct time and wages for my lunch break, sometimes even when I don't have time to take a break? If I resign, how long do I need to wait for my last paycheck? When the boss doesn't come into work, should he, she get a portion of the tips?
Okay, so there's chuckling, like, aww. Tell me, why did you just go, Tell me.
Boss shouldn't get a portion of the tips.
Boss shouldn't get a portion of the tips? Great.
They should get their paycheck before or when they resign.
That's right. They didn't know. Like, if they were, they should get it either that day, right? Or within 5 days, right? What else?
These shouldn't be questions.
Huh?
These shouldn't be questions.
These shouldn't be the questions, huh?
Well, they're very similar to other places like medical residencies and medical students. And I mean, there's a lot of similarity in terms of how people feel on a job when they're at the bottom
uh-huh.
level.
So this is We don't want, traditionally, when you do a health and safety, you'd come in with, how many of you did trips and falls? Do you have masks? Ergonomics? Do you have letters? Blah, 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 right? These are not the kinds of questions you would anticipate. Look at this one. If there's an emergency or a worker gets hurt, should we call 911? Did anybody have any idea why somebody had that discussion around that? What do you think? Huh? Oh, possibly undocumented. Very good. Excellent. What else?
They were told not to the last time that happened.
That's right. So they were told, but the employer was it. Let's call 911. No, you're not calling 911. And it's because they don't want an ambulance. They don't want a police car. They don't want all of this stuff happening outside their restaurant because word would get around. There's something happening there and it would hurt their business, right? The other, these were some of the things that we talked about. No, we were told we cannot call 911. What? The other is in terms of what happens if when a worker gets work, a coworker gets hurt. Stories where they took a worker, one worker got cut, and the story that really stood out to me was they took that worker and carried her around the corner up the street to the emergency hospital, Chinese hospital in the community. And when they got back, they got yelled at. That worker got fired. And they got yelled at and told never, ever do that again. And so that was some of the stories behind, in terms of some of the cultural richness. I only have two more minutes. But the other thing that I want people to understand in terms of the richness, I'm sorry. So going back, just a moment, how do I go back? Going back is these questions were turned into a brochure. That's why you see that other thing. It was turned into a brochure. It starts where people's experience are at. And this was their tool that they created, that they owned. And they went into ESL classes. They distribute this in Portsmouth Square, at street fairs. When they go into the restaurants to talk about people's rights, they would bring this brochure. And this is a starting point. It was there in which they would talk to other people about the restaurant project, about the things that they were fighting for. And this unlocked doors for people to trust them because they saw their own experiences through these questions. I think I just want to end with one of the other final things around this approach, popular education approach, is to really engage people in discussing where they're at and what they would like to see. And I asked the question here, I wanted to know, in terms of a satisfying life, you know, what for you was, I'm satisfied with my life, okay, and my purpose in my life. And one of the things that came out where it says WOC, that's the Worker Organizing Committee, those were the responses from our community, our group discussion. And the the middle two were questions that was asked of mainly the Chinatown residents in San Francisco, okay? And then under US, that's the general population of the United States, that was some of the categories in terms of having a satisfied life. And what was really important to understand is when you get the responses from the study is to help interpret what these responses mean. And then around the issue of health, health came out number one among the participants in our discussion, one and two in the general population of San Francisco Chinatown, and within the United States, it was number eight. And we had a discussion about that. in terms of the implications that had in understanding the data. I just want to end with, for the workers, they said that health is the most important thing. And as I said, everybody else feel that? They said yes. And I said, why? He said, because we, as in our situation as immigrants and not, we don't have access to the kinds of jobs that enables you to use your brains or sit in an office. The kinds of jobs that we take requires that we be physically fit. And if you're not physically fit, then that is tragic. You cannot provide for yourself, you cannot provide for the family, and you're of no use to the community. So health and understanding the importance of the study, it was an aha moment for me to realize how important this work was going to be and the long-lasting impact that it would have. So I'll just end on that, and we can ask questions later. Thank you.
Thank you both, that was spectacular. I wondered how you got the 100 or so restaurants to participate. I mean, that would seem to be a really difficult thing in terms of reviewing the restaurant itself.
Right, going into the restaurants.
Yeah.
So that's the advantage of having a diverse partnership, and our health department partners were able to go along the initial visits that our health department partner did. He tagged along with restaurant inspectors on their routine inspections, and so he gained access that way. But that actually kind of takes a long time. The checklist didn't take him quite as long, and so then he just started, you know, carrying. They all have bags, you know, they all have their identification, and he would just go to restaurants and ask them if he could do the observation day. He'd say, "I'm from the health department. May I look at your restaurant? We're trying out this checklist," and he was allowed in at almost all of the restaurants. Only two of them said no and turned him away. So it, you know, it was that that health department part of it. Mary, or oh, I'm sorry, in front of Mary, right here in the front row.
Would you please repeat the question?
The question was, have there been repercussions for any of the workers that participated in leadership of the study or participate through the study or other things? Surprisingly, no. There is no, we have no reports of anybody being fired or anything like that. Actually, one of the things is that people are learning is that the more visible you are in this, the more protected you are in this. And that's one of the lessons in terms of overcoming the fears. So, it's also stories happen in terms of one woman who was in the back of the house and she was the dishwasher. And she was the one brave enough to sign on to this case, right? And the other workers were like, no, the front of the house, no. But she was signed on to this case. I tell you, when she got her $50,000 check, word got around really fast about, did you hear about the man got $50,000? Oh God, what a fool I was. I was so scared. And that was a lesson learned.
Well, let's go here. I think I saw your hand.
Yeah, I was wondering, so thank you very much. It was like, hugely inspiring. What were your expectations at the start of the project?
The expectations of
the at the start of the project, where did you see things going compared to where they did be?
So the volume is
my expectations.
Sorry, we could.
What were the expectations at the start of the project? What were our expectations? Golly, I just felt that we were going to be able to meet all of the kind of goals that we had set out in a day. Maybe about 1,100 workers would come and work in the restaurants, and we set a goal of 400. I know Mary was like, oh my God, I'm gonna get 400. But I just never had any doubts that we would make it. I don't know how to answer that question.
So this is actually one of the questions I think I asked in the evaluation of the partners, and I think there were a lot of unknowns. I think people felt, from what people would always tell us is outsiders would say, oh, you are never going to get 400 Chinatown restaurant workers to talk to you at that survey, talk about bad working conditions. No, these are workers who don't have a voice. They're workers who will never feel empowered. I think we did hear a lot of naysaying, and then Mary got a lot of it, and the workers felt like 400 is so many, and this survey instrument is so long, and you know, how are we going to do it? So there were a lot of, some of them lasted for 2 hours because they would work with the participants on it. And so I think everybody had these expectations of each other. In fact, we had a partnership conversation that everybody would put in everything that they could to make this partnership work, and then we'll see what happens. And then what happened was pretty amazing. I think for us, I think for me, certainly witnessing just the tremendous, you know, effort on the part of all of our partners, but certainly our worker partners, and that whole development process, and then eventually pushing through this legislation that had citywide impact was really kind of floored me, and was always, you know, such an exciting, inspirational story. Mary, I don't know if you have anything to add to expectations.
No, I did get laughed at by my colleagues
at the School of Public Health when I said we were going to try and get 300 originally workers to do the survey, and they laughed, said, no way you can do that. And then we thought, you know, to hedge our bets and get this grant from CDC, let's make it 400. So it was partly strategic, trying to, you know, go ahead, never believing we would do it. But then it didn't take long into the work to see that this might really happen because of the engagement and the high level of excitement. It really was amazing. Could I just say one more thing, just really important, because I want you all to feel free to eat in Chinatown restaurants. The restaurants, as you know, are all routinely expected, but it's all from the point of view of us customers, not from the point of view of worker health and safety. And that's why that piece, having people go in from the restaurant, the health department, and inspect and look at what's happening to workers, that was new. And one of the first things the health department did long before the data was published was put that instrument on their website, so health departments all over the country, if they want to, can add 15 minutes to their inspections and have that level of added safety.
Wonderful, and especially the popular education like emphasis from the get-go and throughout is just really inspiring. I wondered if you've noticed shifts in how the bosses are actually engaging with the workers, or if there's been any inclination on the participants and to kind of forge different kinds of relationships with the bosses, knowing that in addition to standing up for their rights directly, kind of working more collaboratively with the bosses, or if that's even a possibility.
Right. One of the things out of this, the worker participants and in the general meetings with other workers, very important is they want to be able to work and support good employers. And they want to be able to have some kind of dialogue and to uplift the good employers. So that is something that is on the on the agendas to do, and that's the approach. It's very interesting right now. In the beginning, we had good employers there at the press conference, but they didn't want us to recognize them. They kind of hid in the back, and they don't recognize my restaurant, blah, 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 because they were afraid of what their peers were going to say to them. But then after a few months, a couple of the restaurants say, promoting like, and we have insurance for our workers, right? And so certain kinds of things are being more visible now. And so, yes, there has been some change. And tomorrow, hopefully at this restaurant that we delegated, there'll be some really good news, but they're hiring some high-priced lawyers, so it might take a while.
Thank you very much for this incredible project for social justice. Now we need a step forward. And Pam, you are retired now, but I will not allow you to rest. I challenge you that the next time that I come to San Francisco, I go to a restaurant which is owned by the workers, because that is the really social change, from social justice to social change.
You're absolutely right. One of the things that we are exploring is we have a lot of caregivers in our organization. They provide care for the elderly or children. And we've been exploring things like worker-owned cooperatives and worker-owned caregivers, things like that. And people are exploring things. Restaurants, people are like talking about, they've talked about, you know, managing. We were actually offered restaurant space, but we weren't ready yet. We're not ready. We need to do a lot more education, but absolutely right. That's a wonderful vision, and it's within our scope right now. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the question was about the time commitment and setting expectations for our worker leader partners, and it sounded like you were saying it sounded like they put in a lot of extra time, and you know, how did we kind of build that in or build to that? And you know, I think one of the things I had the privilege of, while doing this evaluation, of documenting a lot of this process, and one of the things that struck me during that process was that the recognition on the part of CPA and Pam and the folks who are organizing these worker partners and leaders in understanding that it's an evolving process, that transformation doesn't happen like that, and that you need to provide a lot of support to people as they're moving that process. And so they started incrementally, and they, you know, I think they did actually spend more time, more of their own time than they were, you know, than they were paid for, because they actually did get stipends, and they did contribute their own time, but it was also that was also a ramped up process. Would you agree, Pam? And where, you know, they started off small. So first, you know, let's get you out there distributing some flyers on wage and hour laws. So that was sort of step one, and that's actually kind of a big step to be out there in the community doing that. Well, then moving on to, a lot of this happened during elections time. So they would make phone calls to people to encourage people to vote, and that would actually be built into the time that they had already committed. So there wasn't a big ask at the very beginning. And the momentum started to build, then these campaigns came along. People, please come to our action. Will you help support these workers who are going after their wages owed to them? So they would go to the actions hide behind the signs. But that was a step, you know. And then more and more, you know, their own commitment grew. They started witnessing, I think, a lot of the power that was building within the community and sort of wanting to be a part of that. And certainly now they're all volunteers and they spend a lot of... No more stipends. And they spend a lot of their time out in the community. And so I would, so I think it was explicit what, you know, what was at the minimum expected of them if they applied for this. And then it was also ramped up and people just became really passionate about what they do.
And they held each other accountable. Hey, you weren't here last time. You were supposed to be here last time. No, I weren't here last time.
So we had a group of students we want to thank who came and now have to take off back to their own classroom. But others we want to keep talking. I think one of the things is that is so evident in this experience is the role of the importance of who your partners are, right? And the diversity. So I'm going to let them walk out. So we can keep talking with Charlotte and Pam, but kind of open it up to, I think one of the beauties of this experience, as I was saying, is that just the importance of who the partners are and the strength of having the Chinese Progressive Association, a 40-year-old organization within the community that had power already in building campaigns, the fact of linking with the health department and the possibilities of influencing kind of their professional work, and that's an incredible partner. The university, of course, and the goal, one of the things I see in this also is a tremendous alignment with values of, shared values of all the, as you said, as someone said, and as both of you said from the beginning, to build in leadership development and community organizing and this interactive popular education approach from the beginning, this shared alignment of all partners to do that, even though you came from different institutions. So some of those kind of set principles of how we work together were deeply embedded here. And so just to open that up a little bit in terms of thinking about partners and partnering that you're doing, if you have questions, continuing for Charlotte and Pam, but also just reflections on how you think about engaging or strengthening existing partnerships from kind of the learnings that you're hearing here. So I wanted to just take that opportunity to broaden it a little bit and talk about, have people share within here. And maybe what we could do first, if you wouldn't mind my doing this, is have you turn to each other for a few minutes and say, what to you are the lessons learned about partnering that you just heard the most? So just take 3 minutes to do that, and then we'll come back together on those lessons. And then also more questions, if wanted. But just, what are the lessons learned for you guys?
I'm sorry.